So our today lecture is going to be on Bohm's rule in the case of two entangled Bohmian qubits. Let me see. Okay, I can change this with that. So I will be here and change it remotely. Okay, so in the last 6 years, I am postdoc of Professor George Kondopoulos, and we are working in Bohmian quantum mechanics, especially Bohmian house. And one of the main research fields is the origin of Bohm's rule in the Bohmian theory. As you may already know, Bohm's rule is not an axiom in Bohmian quantum mechanics, but it's rather a dynamically established theorem. Here, our outline of the present talk, we are going to talk about Bohmian trajectories, then we can cover something about quantum entanglement. Then I will show you some open questions in Bohmian quantum mechanics, and we are going to develop our theory up to based on our numerical results in the case of entangled Bohmian qubits. In the case of entangled Bohmian qubits. So, a refresher, Bohmian trajectories. As you already know, Bohmian quantum mechanics is an alternative interpretation theory of quantum mechanics, where the quantum particles, besides the usual Schrödinger equation, are also described by their positions. So, in Bohmian mechanics, the quantum particles are guided by the usual wave function, the solution of Schrödinger's equation, and their evolution is described by the so-called Bohmian equations of motion, which are shown here. Excuse me? So, so here you have a first-order deterministic set of differential equations, which are based on the solution of the usual Schrödinger equation psi. Excuse me? Okay. So here you see the quantity G, this denominator, which is equal to psi real squared plus psi imaginary squared, which is nothing else than the probability density. The usual probability density of the wave function as in standard quantum mechanics. Whenever G goes close to zero, the Bohmian equations exhibit almost infinite velocities, and C is zero at the so-called nodal points of or the nodes of the wave function. So in Bohmian mechanics, we have seen in the past, both in ARCAM and in other institutes, that the nodal points are the main reason for the emergence of chaos in Bohmian systems. We have shown, the group of ARCAM has shown in the past in 2009 with Professor George Kondopoulos and Christos Efthymiopoulos, the most general theoretical framework for the emergence of chaos in two-dimensional Bohmian systems, which is a so-called nodal point X point complex, according to which whenever a quantum particle comes close to a nodal point of the wave function, it gets scattered, it gets deflected by a hyperbolic point, the so-called X point, which is always close to every given nodal point. And it has a special property. It is a stagnant point in the frame of reference of the moving nodal point. So we are going to further explain the nodal point exponent complex mechanism in the subsequent pages. Now, another refresher, what is entanglement? In quantum mechanics, we say that two or more quantum systems are entangled if their joint wave vector cannot be written as a tensor product of their independent wave vectors. Namely, it is impossible to measure a property of system A without affecting immediately, it is a non-local feature of quantum mechanics, system B, and vice versa. even if A and B may exist in space like distances. They, A and B may interact now, then get at great, they can get a great distance between them in the future, but still they are described by a joint wave vector, which is not the tensor product of the two wave vectors of system A and system B. Entanglement is a manifestation of the non-local nature of quantum mechanics, and it has a key role in quantum information and quantum computation theory, since it has been shown to be the basic prerequisite for the designation of quantum computing algorithms. So it is an interesting future of quantum mechanics, probably the most interesting one. And we are trying to observe the way quantum entanglement affects the Bohmian trajectories. So some open questions in Bohmian quantum mechanics. First of all, how can we observe entanglement via Bohmian trajectories? How does entanglement affect ordered and chaotic trajectories? Another one, maybe the most interesting. Bohn's rule is not an axiom in Bohmian quantum mechanics, as I said before. However, it has never been doubted by the experiment. So if we take as a given fact that Bohmian, the Bohn's rule is valid always, what is the mechanism that leads to the establishment of Bohn's rule in the case of an arbitrary initial distribution or Bohmian distribution with initial probability density, which is not psi zero squared? So what is the role of entanglement in the dynamical approximation of Bohn's rule in Bohmian mechanics? Too many questions, very little answers, but we have made a series of works with a very strong numerical background, many simulations here in the ARCAM. So you are going to see some of our results. Now, what is a qubit? In full correspondence to the with the classical bit, a qubit is the basic unity of quantum information. Any quantum system with two well-defined quantum mechanically separated states can play the role of a qubit. So you know the classical bit, which can take the values 0 or 1, okay? And it is actually a switch. In quantum mechanics, a qubit is ket psi is equal to c1 ket 0 c plus c2 ket 1. But the main difference between the classical bit and the quantum bit is that in the quantum case, we have the superpositions. The quantum bit, the qubit, can take all the superpositions between 0 and 1. And this is this can be handled by changing the coefficients C1 and C2. The coefficients C1 and C2 are complex numbers, and according to the preservation of probability, they must sum up their squares, must sum up to zero, according to Bohr's rule. This is the standard quantum mechanics.
To one, to unity, yes, correct.
To zero, I'm sure. The quantum interference between zero and one is responsible for the different behavior of qubits in comparison with the classical bits. And this might be the big benefit with working in the quantum regime. Now, the physical realization of qubits is not unique. There are several candidates of different nature. Some of them are spin qubits, most of them. Some of them are superconducting qubits, as you may have seen in the literature. Some of them are photonic qubits. The community prefers to follow an operational task approach. So what every experiment can be seen with different realizations of qubits. It is an operational task approach. So there is no physical qubit, a unique physical qubit. Now here, in the next pages, we are going to see some ideal mathematical qubits, Bohmian qubits, made of coherent states of the quantum harmonic oscillator. A coherent state is a special quantum state very important in quantum optics, of the quantum harmonic oscillator, which is characterized by minimum uncertainty. The product delta H times delta P is minimum. Thus, its behavior resembles closely that of a classical harmonic oscillator. From a technical point of view, mathematically, they are defined as the eigenstates of the annihilation operator A associated to the eigenvalue A, where A is a complex number, is a complex eigenvalue, since operator A is non-Hermitian. So the wave function, without wanting to confuse you with details, here is, the wave function that we are working with. This wave function is going to be inserted in the Bohmian equations, and we are going to see the subsequent trajectories. So if this parameter A, which is the amplitude of the oscillation in the coherent states, is chosen to be large enough, then the inner product between two coherent states is practically zero. In general, the inner product between two arbitrary coherent states is not zero, but here we managed to do an engineering in order to make them statistically independent. So in order to construct two well-defined states. So here is our mathematical realization of the qubit, where our psi is A ket R, where R means right, and this means shows this is represented by this Gaussian blob, and B is from and L means left. So we have two Gaussian blobs, which start on the right and on the left from the center of the oscillation, and this they start to evolve, and their motion is like this one. They make oscillations, but at any time, at every instance, their inner product is very, very close to zero. So, in essence, they represent a quantum bit. Now, the states that we have chosen to work with are of this kind, where psi is C1 tensor product RL. We have two qubits, so we have one in the x-axis and one on the psi axis. So we have this combination, and this combination is not randomly chosen. This combination is very important in quantum information theory, because it's actually, if we call R 0 and L 1, it's C1 0 1 and C2 1 0, which is the most general case of two entangled qubits. And by properly choosing the coefficients C1 and C2, we can manipulate its entanglement from a zero entanglement, which is the product state, okay, up to maximally entangled state, which is the so-called psi plus Bell state. So a very common wave vector in standard quantum mechanics is going to be studied with Bohmian trajectories. If we insert the previous formula about the wave function in this equation, then we are going to find the probability density psi squared of this form, which depends of the amount on the amount of quantum entanglement. In general, it is going to be a superposition of two Gaussian blobs whose heights are determined by the amount of quantum entanglement. So in the case of maximal entangled state, the Bell state, these two blobs are identical. They are completely equal. And if
not,
we-
Not identical, but equal.
Equal, yes, not identical. Okay, because they are at different positions, but they are practically the same. By decreasing the quantum entanglement, one of them becomes smaller and smaller. And in the case, in the extreme case of zero entanglement, where we have the product state, this disappears. And so we have only one Gaussian blob wandering around the configuration space. These two blobs collide every in the progress of time. And at the times of the collisions, the Bohmian particles that follow every one of them get mixed by chaotic scattering. This is the times, these are the times where Gauss becomes emergent. So Gauss in this system is produced by the chaotic scattering events made at the times of the collision of the two blobs of the probability density psi squared. So another interesting feature of our system is that by choosing a large enough amplitude for the oscillation, our system becomes identical to a two-qubit spin system by four times four density matrix in the standard basis 0, 1. What I mean here is that we can quantify perfectly the quantum entanglement by calculating analytically its entanglement entropy, which is the most common, the most usual entanglement measure in two dimensions. Consequently, the entanglement can be manipulated by changing, by altering only one parameter, the coefficient C2 here. So C2 equal to zero means product state, and C2 equal to SQRT 2 over 2, square root of 2, one half of that is the maximal entangled state where the two blobs are just equal. So as I said in the first pages, the nodal points are crucial for the generation of Gauss in Bohmian mechanics. Another interesting feature and very important feature of our model is that its nodal points can be analytically computed, something that is not the case in general. So in our case, the nodal points of psi read x node and psi node as in, given in equations 11 and 12. And as you can see, we have this parameter kappa, which extends from minus infinity to plus infinity by odd or even values, depending on the product of C1 times C2. So for C1 times C2 less than zero, here we have a typo. If this is greater than zero, then k kappa is odd, while if C1, C2 less than zero, kappa is even or zero. This was a typo. Similar relations hold for other states, as the phi Bell state of quantum information. Consequently, this is the important fact. Consequently, there exist infinitely many nodal points in space for any given time. So we have infinitely many places in the configuration space where an incoming trajectory can be deflected. And it's going to be deflected by a geometrical form by a nodal point X point complex, which whose typical form is that one, as Arkham has shown in the past. Here we have the frame of reference of the moving nodal point. We can take, this is an instance, okay? So we freeze the time and we are transforming our equations to the frame of reference of the moving nodal point, okay? And we find that close to the nodal point where the velocity of the Bohmian trajectory becomes infinitely large, there is always a second stagnant point, not moving in the frames of reference of the moving nodal point, which is called the X point. And this is proven to be a hyperbolic point, which scatters in this way or in that way the incoming trajectories. And the local Lyapunov number undergoes a positive shift. The cumulative action of such many scattering events between the trajectories and the X points produces the chaos that we see in Bohmian trajectories. So here we have four different pictures for different amounts of entanglement. It doesn't matter. We don't care about that for the time being. But we saw the multiple nodal trajectories of the nodal points in time. This is a cumulative representation. So you see that almost every part, not all the, of the configuration space, is covered by the nodal points. But there are some areas, that some blank areas, where the nodes and consequently the nodal point X point complexes do not enter. In these areas, we have the greater degree of probability to find ordered trajectories, because the Bohmian equations which do not encounter nodal point X point complexes are ordered. Okay, so in general, ordered and chaotic trajectories coexist in every experiment in Bohmian quantum mechanics. And one has first to find the positions of the nodal points in order to monitor the evolution. So here we have some color plots. These color plots have been made in this way. If you let a trajectory evolve in a very large amount of time, then the trajectory is going to cover all of the configuration space if it is chaotic, probably, okay? And if you try to represent it on the paper, you will find nothing interesting. All of this region, all this region is going to be covered by a single color, and you won't get any, you won't access any information about the dynamics. 2 or 3 years ago, I think 2018, something like that, we tried to find the underlying dynamics between the chaotic, the long limit, long time limit behavior of the chaotic and ordered trajectories. So we tried to discretize, to make a square grid in two dimensions and count how many times a trajectory passes through every cell of this grid. You see the black region. The black region means that we have no encounters. So we do not find the trajectory in this place. In general, the part of the configuration space which is going to be covered by the Bohmian trajectories depends on the so-called support of the wave function. And by saying the word support, we mean the region of the configuration space where the probability density psi squared is large enough, does not vanish. So even if our problem in general can extend to infinity, practically it is always confined to a very distinct region of space. So if we make this discretization and we count and then count the occupation number of every cell of our grid, then we see figures like that. And I'm going to explain you further about their structure. Here we have some initial distributions, some individual distributions, so only one particle, here up to 70,000 time units, okay, which is for very weak entanglement. Actually, C2 is of order 10 up to minus 5. So it's very, it's almost a perturbation. Okay. And you see this distinctive structure, which is seen practically also here for different initial conditions between these two figures. These are both of them are chaotic trajectories. And what we saw is that after very large times, they are going to be represented by the same long limit distribution of their points. This one seems to have covered all of the place, all of the support of the wave function as those two, but you see a different distribution of the colors. This is just a transcendental region between reaching the final behavior. And you see that whether, even if this is also a chaotic trajectory, for a large time, it gets trapped in a certain region of space and seems like an ordered trajectory, but it is not. An ordered trajectory, an ordered trajectory is here, when you see that we have a distribution, actually. Αυτό. Έλα να το κάνεις. Έλα να το κάνεις. Έλα να το κάνεις, γιατί δεν το ξέρω. Excuse me. Τέλεια. Okay, thank you. So here we have an ordered trajectory, an unusual ordered trajectory, which in our case is just a superposition of two Lissajous figures in x and psi directions. So we have found one Lissajous figure made of two oscillations in x and psi axis. Okay, so we found that all of the chaotic trajectories are going to reach the same limiting behavior by these color plots. Excuse me, next. Now, we are going to the opposite regime of strong entanglement, where C2 is close to the Bell state, refers to values of entanglement close to the Bell state. Here we see a different figure for the long limit behavior of the trajectories. And we see that all of them, independently from the initial conditions, they reach the practically the same again figure, the same figure. So what we have found numerically is that all the chaotic trajectories for every given amount of the entanglement, in the case of two Bohmian entangled qubits, they have the same long limit behavior, and we call them ergodic because they cover all of the trajectory, all of the support of the wave function. And this is something new. So now here you see Max Born, and here you see David Bohm. So we have Bohm's rule in Bohmian quantum mechanics. Okay, and we are trying to analyze to study the origin of Bohm's rule in Bohmian quantum mechanics with our findings and with our theoretical mechanism about the generation of chaos in Bohmian systems. Here, what we have is a figure about the preservation of Bohm's rule. So we have, you imagine that we have here and here the two Gaussian blobs in the case of the maximally entangled state, which when they are equal. And then we distribute a number of quantum particles. I think that they are about 2,400 here, according to Bohm's rule, to P equals psi squared. And what we see is that that after the encounters of the two blobs, the trajectories are mixed in such a way that Bohm's rule is always preserved. Actually, P we already know that in Bohmian quantum mechanics, if one starts with
Παρακαλούμε, κλείστε τα μικρόφωνά σας, αν έχετε την καλοσύνη, γιατί ακούγεται ήχη από εσάς, από μέσα κάπως, ή να έχει ανοιχτό μικρόφωνο.
So, in Bohmian mechanics, if Bohm's rule is initially satisfied, then it is always satisfied as time increases. So, here is just a demonstration of this fact, where we see that the Bohmian trajectories get mixed. They interchange the two blobs, but statistically they always follow p equal psi squared. Now we leave the case of single trajectories, and we try to see what happens in the case of collective distributions of many particles. Here we have C2 equal to zero, so we have a product state, and we see that the superposition of many of thousands of 250 Lissajous figures actually produces a figure like that, which seems very close to the one of the strong to the case of the strong entanglement. Maybe we can say something more about that as an extreme case later. And then we see again what happens in the case of very, very small amount of entanglement, where we see where the chaotic trajectories, which are initiated by the small blob of the wave function, they always reach the final limiting behavior. And what we see here is a different case, an extreme case, where the Bohm's rule is not going to be approximated over the course of time by the chaotic trajectory in the case of C2 equal 0.001, very, very small amount of entanglement and very large integration time. So we found this exceptional example where the Bohm's rule is not going to be found for every initial distribution, for any arbitrary distribution of Bohmian particles. What I want to say without confusing you is that we see that the crucial parameter about for the dynamical establishment of Bohm's rule is not the nature of the trajectories, but the ratio between ordered and chaotic trajectories in our initial distribution. Many more figures like that. Maybe I can confuse you with so many of them, excuse me. So here we have an interesting case where we make initial distribution in two different regions of the configuration space for a given amount of entanglement and a given integration time. And you see that we have totally different behavior. These two figures are not the same, as is obvious. This one follows the Bohm's rule. So we have 250 particles, which are distributed initially according to Bohm's rule, and they reach the final distribution of this figure. But if we change the region of the initial distribution, then we find this behavior. What we have done here is that in this region, all of the trajectories of our distribution are chaotic and they produce this final figure. But in this case, some of them, and actually many of them, because we have a very small degree of entanglement, are ordered. So this initial distribution is dominated by ordered trajectories. But this one has no ordered trajectories, so it is never going to reach Bohm's rule. Here we have this figure, which shows the amount the percentage of the chaotic trajectories in the leading blob of the wave function according to the quantum entanglement. And you see that whenever quantum entanglement goes to the maximal entangled case, is in the regime of strong entanglement values, then Hausch dominates. While in the case of small entanglement values here, we have many, many order trajectories. Okay, so in this case, the role of order trajectories is crucial. But as I said before, our chaotic trajectories, they are always ergodic. That is why we can start with any initial distribution in the configuration space, any initial distribution. And if this initial distribution, no matter starts with Bonjour or not, if it has the correct ratio between ordered and chaotic trajectories, it is going to reach Bonjour rule after a certain amount of time. If it does not have the correct ratio, then we will not see Bonjour rule, according to our numerical findings, at least. So, too many questions from our study. Very, very difficult and open questions. So we have here a very simple quantum system, just a qubit, which, okay, it may have a difficult wave function, but anyway, it's nothing more than two entangled qubits, which is practically a mathematical model. And it's characterized by so complex dynamics. What happens with more degrees of freedom? Okay. What happens in the most interesting case of the initially mixed states? Because we, in Bohmian mechanics, we are used to work with pure states. We assume to know the initial, the solution of the Schrödinger equation, the wave function. And then we can work on the Bohmian equations and see the trajectories. But this is not always true. And actually, in the majority of times, we have to simultaneously solve the Schrödinger equation and find then the trajectories of the particles. So what is the relation between ergodicity and entanglement? Is always ergodicity present in Bohmian mechanics? This is something to be studied in the future, probably by our team. What is the relation between ergodicity and Bohn's rule? All of these questions are entangled. They are not; they cannot be separated, because in the evolution of the Bohmian trajectories, besides the numerical difficulties about their integration, because as you saw in the previous pictures, we have nodal points, and the integration of the differential equations becomes very difficult in their neighborhood. We have also the interplay between very, very important and very, very central notions of quantum mechanics, like entanglement, probably like quantum discord, which has never been studied in the field of Bohmian mechanics. So it is a fundamental work, and I don't think that we will find the ultimate solutions, but we can work on the phenomenology and try to understand what will happen in real systems. Okay. So since 2019, our work has been published about four times with Professor Kondopoulos and Dr. Christos Efimiopoulos. Most of them are in Physica Scripta and one in Physical Review, E. We have four papers which cover the case of two Bohmian qubits. We are working on step by step and try to understand what happens. This is not a very easy job to do, because there are too many cases to be covered. And nowadays, probably in a future talk, we can see our results in 3D, in three entangled qubits, which I think we are the first one to work with. And the simulations there are much more complex and difficult. But anyway, we are trying to understand how the dimensionality of the system affects the generation of Gauss, and this Gauss generation affects consequently the dynamical establishment of Born's rule, because Born's rule is always there. So we try to understand how the theory produced it for any extreme choice of initial distribution. Okay, so and now a joke. There are three types of people in this world. Those people who understand quantum mechanics, those who do not understand quantum mechanics, and those who both simultaneously do and do not understand quantum mechanics. I found it yesterday, so I think I am in the third class, and I try to, probably I will reach the second one, but my dream is to come close to the first one. So, thank you.